Good morning and welcome. I'm so happy to be with you here this morning. We're going to start with Ella's song. These words were written in the words of Ella Baker, a civil rights activist in the 1960s. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes, until the killing of black men, black mothers, sons, is as important as the killing of white men, white mothers, sons. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Young people come first. They have the courage where we fail. And if we can but shed some light, they will carry us through the gale. The older we get, the better we know that the secret of our going on is when the reins are in the hands of the young who dare to run again. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Not needing to clutch for power, not needing the light just to shine on me. I need to be one in the number as we stand against tyranny. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Everything is gonna be all right. Everything is gonna be all right. Pray on just a little while longer. Pray on just a little while longer. Pray on just a little while longer. I know justice is coming soon. I know justice is coming soon. Sing on just a little while longer. Sing on just a little while longer. Sing on just a little while longer. Everything is gonna be all right. Everything is gonna be all right. Fight on just a little while longer. Fight on just a little while longer. Fight on just a little while longer. I know justice is coming soon. I know justice is coming soon.
Good morning. Welcome everyone to White Bear Unitarian Universalist Church. We are a congregation in the free faith tradition, a community of youth, adults, and children dedicated to pluralism in the spiritual search and ethics grounded in action. I am Reverend Jack Gady, Assistant Minister. We're grateful to share this space with you. This morning, our production team has been having some issues with internet connectivity, especially those of us with CenturyLink. Some of you might also be experiencing those issues. Please know that the service will be recorded, and for now, we get to take a breath and practice patience. Service participants today include Amy Peterson Derrick, Carol Coette, and Victoria Safford, supported by Aaron Scott. Music today is from Carol Coette and Craig Hansen and the WBUUC Choir, directed by Thaxter Cuneo. Today, after the service at 11:15, we hope that you will join us for Cyber Social Hour. We'll put the Zoom link and easy instructions in the chat box. Welcome to our church. Together we grow our souls and serve the world. Just one moment, Victoria. You're still on mute, actually. Here we go. Let's try that again.
Victoria, we're still having trouble hearing you. Sorry, Victoria.
Aha.
Okay. We're going to try this one more time.
Third time's charm.
Okay. You can hear that? All right. Come in. Come into this space which we make holy by our presence. Come in with all your vulnerabilities and strengths, fears and anxieties, loves and hopes. For here you need not hide nor pretend, nor be anything other than who you are and who you are called to be. Come into this space where we can heal and be healed, forgive and be forgiven. Come into this space where the ordinary is sanctified, the human is celebrated, the compassionate is expected. Come into this space. Together we make it a holy space. Jean Doolittle will light the chalice.
Good morning. I'm Jean Doolittle. I was raised on a small dairy farm just outside of Mille Lacs, Minnesota. To feed the animals, each spring my father would plant crops of corn and oats, but only after harvesting the first crop of the season, the rocks. In fields that had been smoothly plowed the fall before, the frost heaves brought up a new crop of rocks. And after lots of back-breaking labor, they were added to our significantly long and high rock piles that delineated the border of our property. I grew up and I went to college and my parents retired from the farm, but the rock pile remained a staple of my childhood mythology. It was a place where I had climbed and explored and staged adventurous photo shoots for my Barbie dolls. Years later, my husband and I visited the farm. The people who bought it from my parents still live there, and we asked them if we could take some rocks from the rock pile to landscape our new home. Well, today, I sit before a small rock garden wall built from those ancient Minnesota rocks, perhaps 3,600 million years old. Some of the oldest rocks on the planet can be found in Minnesota. They carry the story, the big story of life on Earth, but they also carry the small story of my homes, my old and the new, and the connection between them. I make a chalice today to honor the rocks in our lives, the steadfast, solid foundations of trustworthy people, ideas, and institutions that ground our personal and our collective lives. Now, our lives and our problems are ephemeral, but the deep truths are eternal. Let them be rocks for us in these troubled times.
Please join me in the opening words. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Please join me in the opening hymn, number 38, Morning Has Broken.
Good morning. On my home altar, I keep several objects that remind me of my childhood home congregations. These objects have moved with me wherever I have gone and have always reminded me of the lessons and the people that have formed the foundations of my Unitarian Universalist faith. One of these cherished objects is a small brown pouch containing 5 smooth stones. These were gifted to me and to each of my classmates who completed the coming of age rite of passage program in the 9th grade in my church. We were told that each of these 5 stones represented the tools that Unitarian minister and teacher James Luther Adams suggested that we each have as religious liberals, touchstones for us to turn to whenever we feel unsure or when the way forward is unclear. These tools are, simply put, learning, community, justice and love, action, and hope. I've been thinking a lot lately about our 3rd and 4th stones, the stones of justice and love and the stone of action. As we have heard so many calls for justice in our world recently, what is my faith calling me to do? It can feel overwhelming. So when I look at these stones, I'm reminded of James Luther Adams' suggestion that the power of thought isn't enough when it comes to justice and peace. That we can quietly hold ideas about justice and peace all we want, but these ideas only really begin to mean something when we begin to live them out loud in the world, even and especially when it is hard. This idea reminds me of a story about a famous Buddhist teacher named Patril Rinpoche. Patril Rinpoche was known to wander around bringing his lessons to people far and wide, and often while in disguise so that people would not recognize him. One day, Patril heard a rumor about a wise old man who had been living all by himself in a mountain cave for over 20 years, contemplating and perfecting patience. And so Patrol, after a long journey, finally came upon the cave of this master of patience, and without waiting for an invitation, walked right inside the cave. "Hello," came a voice from the dark. "Who are you?" "Who am I indeed?" answered Patrol. "That is the question, isn't it? Who am I? Who are you? Who are any of us, really?" After a few moments of silence, the calm voice of the wise man came again. "Why are you here?" "Another great query," exclaimed Patrol. "Isn't that the question we are all pondering? Why are we here? What is the greatest goal in this life?" "You ask great questions," Patrol laughed and invited himself to sit on the floor next to the master, who had clearly been interrupted from his morning meditations. Patrol took a deep breath and looked at the wise old man and said, "So, what are we thinking about today?" The old man was clearly becoming a little annoyed. "Sir, I am thinking of the same thing I have been thinking about for over 20 years, patience." The wise man's voice wasn't as calm as it had been before, but he went on, "In all of that time, I have led a simple life of meditation and watching the seasons come and go. I have perfected patience." "Oh, how wonderful," exclaimed Patrol. "Let me try." And so when the wise old man stood up and looked outside, Patrol stood up and looked outside. When the wise old man sat for meditation, Patrol sat for meditation, carefully being sure to match the wise old man's every movement and breath and heavy sigh the best he could. "Psst," said Patrol at last. "What are we going to do next? This is getting a little boring." At that, the wise old man stood up, his eyes wide. "Why can't you just leave me to my retreat? Please leave my cave at once." "I will leave," said Patrol, "but it looks as if your patience has already left." It would have been easy for the wise old man to quietly perfect patience without interruption in his unchallenged and safe space and his thoughts alone. But what happens when we are challenged? How are we practicing living out loud our beliefs in patience or justice or love when an unexpected guest shows up at the door to our mountain caves? May we be reminded to work towards growing and serving together, not just quietly in unchallenged and safe spaces, but especially when it's hard. Bravely, out loud, and every single day.
Please join me for a moment as we pray and meditate. Meditate on the highs and lows, the mountains and the valleys. We notice and honor the multiple facets of this precious gem we call life. Even when the sharp angles cut us, and when all we really want is a smooth and calming stone to hold in the palm of our hands. Sometimes when we meditate on this life, we find jagged edges and harsh beauty. And even then, the value of the treasure is maintained. And so we settle in, we take a breath, and we wait. We pray, speaking our desires and aspirations out loud, not so that the world will necessarily change. We pray and hope and ask for what our world needs, so that we will remember what we need, what others need. We pray to remind ourselves that we are not self-contained units. We are not sealed off from bias, influence, cause, and effect. These acts of reminder and remembering help us retrain our brains toward mindfulness, toward compassion, curiosity, toward complexity. When we meditate on the ways we have fallen short from reaching our goals, we become aware how much grace we require. And when we meditate on our own need for grace, we become more gracious toward others. In that space of graciousness and openness, we pause. We take a moment to ponder the names and faces and stories of the people on our hearts and our minds this morning. Whether you say their names out loud or silently in the quiet of your spirit, we hold them in light and in love. We settle in, we take a breath, and we wait. Our community is made stronger with the addition of your voice, of your prayer, with your intention, and with your presence. May we be blessed, and may we be a blessing. May it be so, and make it so. Amen. Your gifts are needed more than ever. Today's offering will go towards supporting the missions and vision of our church community. Please be generous. Our first reading is by Ada Limone, A New National Anthem. The truth is, I've never cared for the national anthem. If you think about it, it's not a good song. Too high for most of us with the rocket's red glare. And then there are the bombs. Always, always, there is war and bombs. Once I sang it at homecoming and threw even the tenacious high school band off key. But the song didn't mean anything, just a call to the field, something to get through before the pummeling of youth. And what of the stanzas we never sing? The third that mentions no refuge could save the hireling and the slave? Perhaps the truth is, every song of this country has an unsung third stanza, something brutal snaking underneath us as we blindly sing the high notes, with a beer sloshing in the stands, hoping our team wins. Don't get me wrong, I do like the flag, how it undulates in the wind like water, elemental. When it's not a weapon, when it flickers, when it folds up so perfectly you can keep it until it's needed, until you can love it again, until the song in your mouth feels like sustenance, a song where the notes are sung by even the ageless woods, the short grass plains, the Red River Gorge, the fistful of land left unpoisoned. That song, that's our birthright, that's sung in silence when it's too hard to go on, that sounds like someone's rough fingers weaving into another's, that sounds like a match being lit in an endless cave, the song that says, my bones are your bones, and your bones are my bones, and isn't that enough? The second reading is from an interview this week with America Ferrera, an actor, on the 100th anniversary of the passage of the 19th Amendment. The fight for suffrage is not over. It isn't like, oh great, women have access to the vote. Our democracy is now full and whole and healthy. I spend a lot of time thinking about who still doesn't have access to that system. There are true obstacles to our participation in this democracy. It's all well and good to celebrate what has been achieved, but it's also our responsibility to ask, what is the present day fight?
As we come marching, marching, unnumbered women dead, go crying through our singing their ancient call for bread. Small art and love and beauty, the trudging spirits knew. Yes, it is bread we fight for, but we fight for roses too. As we go marching, marching, we bring the greater days. The rising of the women means the rising of the race. No more the drudge and idler, tend that toil where one reposes, but a sharing of life's glories, bread and children, and we mother them again. Our day shall not be sweated from birth until life closes. Heart, starve as well as bodies, give us bread, but give us roses. As we go marching, marching in the beauty of the day, a million darkened kitchens, a thousand mill lofts gray, our touch with all the radiance, the sudden sun discloses, for the people hear us singing, bread and marching, 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 marching.
This has been a week, has it not? This has been a week on the far end of a summer that has been a summer, nestled inside a year that has been, at least so far, a year, the fourth of four long years, which began in 2016, and they have been a time. This has been a time this week, and before we go another step, I want to invite you to take a breath again. Close your eyes if you want. Breathe deep, the breath of life, the spirit of life. Your breath, even there inside your house, inside your chest, joining you to every living thing that's breathing now or ever has. Your breath joining you to everyone, to all of us. And see if breathing in and out, you can take a breath of gratitude, a gulp of gratitude for the beauty of the day. This morning, which has broken just like the first morning, spilling light all over the place, born of the one light Eden saw play. See if breathing in, you can gather calm and gratitude, and then breathe out a prayer of love and hope to Jacob Blake and his family across the river in Wisconsin. Breathe out prayers of love and memory to the families of Joseph Rosenbaum and Anthony Huber. Breathe out a prayer of healing to Gage Grosskreutz. And breathing in again, still calm, breathe out a prayer for the officer and a prayer for the shooter in the street, for breath joins us always and forever to every living thing that's breathing now or ever has. Breathe in and out and find space within your spirit for the beauty and the promise of this day. The poet Ross Gay has a lovely meditation. He says, "I suspect it is simply a feature of being an adult, what I call being grown or a grown person, to have endured some variety of thorough emotional turmoil, to have made your way to the brink, and if you're lucky, to have stepped back from it, if not permanently, then for some time or time to time. Then it is, too, a kind of grownness by which I see three squares of light on my wall, the shadow of a tree trembling in two of them, and hear the train going by and feel no panic or despair, feel no sense of doom or horrible alignment, but simply observe the signs, light and song, for what they are, light and song. And knowing what I have felt before and might feel again, I feel now a sense of relief, which is cousin to, or rather water to, delight." Even in the hardest of times, the hardest of weeks, may there be spaces of calm, spaces for gratitude, for the morning, for each other. May we notice the light and the songs of birds, songs of children, song of a train passing by, and know that even in the midst of grief, the midst of serious fear for our country and our world, even in the midst of boiling rage and helpless, fist-pounding frustration, even in the midst of bone weariness, there is space for beauty, even joy. And like water, it brings life. Breathe deep. Drink deep. The quote Jack read to us from America Ferrera is from a set of 11 interviews this past week with American women, ranging in age from 13 years old to 110, one for every decade since the ratification of the 19th Amendment, granting women the right to vote in this country. Each of those women asked to speak about what this means now to them personally. From Ruthie Thompson, who at 110 years old, clearly remembers being 10 years old on August 26, 1920, to Mari Kopany, a young water rights activist, a troubler of the waters of complacency and greed, who for so much of her life, like so many other kids she knows, for most of her life on earth, has drunk and bathed in bottled water because no other kind is safe in her home in Flint, Michigan. Her family can't afford it. but all the water's bottled. And she knows how wrong that is, and she fights for change in Michigan and everywhere, and believes young citizens like herself, whose lives and health and bodies and brain development are affected every day by policies enacted by adults, she believes young citizens like herself should have the right to vote. Take a breath before you roll your eyes and say, that's crazy, kids can't vote. Because that's exactly what women were told for two centuries in America. It's exactly what Black people were told and still are told by legal and illegal voter suppression. And Native people and poor people and people in prison and people with disabilities like Kiara Marshall, also interviewed, a 27-year-old Black model who lost a leg at age 10 when a drunk driver ran her down. She says, quote, what we need to do is make voting more accessible. Sometimes you have to drive and drive and drive before you reach a voting station, and then you get there and they close it. It makes it so hard for people with disabilities and elderly people, people who can't drive for whatever reason. And some people, like me, can't stand in line for 6 hours on a prosthetic leg. This week, celebrating 100 years of women's suffrage, it's good to take a breath before rolling our eyes at any suggestion of any infringement of the franchise and hear first from those most affected. Hear first from the margins of democracy and the frayed edges of freedom. The fight for suffrage isn't over, says America Ferreira. It isn't like, oh great, women have access to the vote. Our democracy is now full and whole and healthy. I spend a lot of time, she says, thinking about who still doesn't have access to the system. There are true obstacles to our participation in democracy. It's all well and good to celebrate what's been achieved, but it is also our responsibility to ask, what is the present day fight? The present day fight for justice, equality, freedom, civil rights, human rights, from the right to vote without impediment or obstruction, to the right not to be shot in the back 7 times while your 3 children look on from the back seat of the car. The movements that we're in the midst of now carry forward older movements, and they build on the principles and power, the vision and brilliance, and the imperfection of past struggles. I don't think there really are separate eras. History writes it that way, but time is a continuum. And at some point, you might trade your corset and your bustle for a t-shirt, but you're still traveling the same long march for liberation, singing and striving together. I was reminded this week, paging through so much history of the women's suffrage movement, this amazing legacy of courageous and creative and often improbable activism, how even the most inspiring, most beautiful chapters of that story are shadowed through and through by failures we see clearly now, if we're willing to look, the failures of racism and classism. White supremacy poisons every page, and there is no vaccine. I was reminded how part of the struggle in every age is to move forward better, to weave into our work every step of the way more honesty, more truth, more humility, more complexity, and more fidelity, more faithfulness to the deepest, broadest values and convictions that on our own and all together we say we mean to hold, to practice our religion better. Adrienne Marie Brown, a queer Black activist, philosopher, agent of change, says in her book, Emergent Strategy, that she's learning to work more collaboratively, not so much on her own, and to measure success not only by clear victories, but by how we travel toward them, mindful that some things, but not all, and perhaps not most, will be completely fixed or transformed in our lifetime. She says success could look like this at the end of a day. I am living a life I don't regret. I am living a life that will resonate with my ancestors and with as many generations forward as I can imagine. I am attending to the crises of my time with my best self. I am of communities that are doing our collective best to honor our ancestors and all humans to come. This is life work, she says, life work with benefits. To me, it's a reminder that all this work for social justice, all this marching, organizing, dreaming, is as spiritual as it is political. It reminds me that years ago, when I first worked with the Quakers in the American Friends Service Committee, and from there stumbled into divinity school, it was because I was having difficulty, and I'd always had difficulty, and I still do, in discerning the difference, the line between the life of the spirit and the life of engagement, transformation, action, and sometimes direct action, the contemplative life and the active or activist life. To me, it's all of a piece, round and round, the call to service, call to prayer, and the struggle in every age, every movement, is to stay true to, keep faith with a sacred vision, bifocal vision, to see this world both as it is unflinchingly and as it could be unflinchingly. In 1850, in a staged and blatant action of defiance, civil disobedience, Susan B. Anthony was arrested in Rochester, New York for voting before women legally could. She was pardoned for that recently, but she would be the first to scorn that gesture. Mostly though, through most of the 19th century, leaders in the movement for women's right to vote had not yet learned or dared to couple their formidable organizing skills with direct action or public demonstrations. Throughout the 1800s and even long before that, the movement was about networking, fundraising, lobbying, building databases of thousands of contacts, all by hand on index cards and in leather-bound ledgers written by candlelight. It was about mass marketing through penny postcards and pamphlets and tracts, the social media platforms of the time, and crowdfunding the costs of travel and speeches and lectures by literally passing their hats, which may be why they wore such big ones. This was organizing at a cellular level, establishing women's clubs and guilds, thousands of them, quietly infiltrating the drawing rooms of sewing circles, quilting bees, and the minds and hearts of church ladies of all denominations and their husbands, for many, many men were in it also. It wasn't until the turn of the century that women added to this steady, solid work behind the scenes a much more visible, public, noisy strategy of mass demonstrations, rallies and parades, banners, buttons, civil disobedience, like the silent sentinels chaining themselves to the White House gates, and other actions elsewhere, mass arrests, hunger strikes, and then the concurrent and carefully crafted public relations campaigns to illuminate the barbarous treatment, not only of suffragists in jail, but everybody in jail. They organized parades in small towns and major cities, flooding the streets with hundreds and thousands of people. They became, said one historian, really good at making sure suffrage was a topic on everyone's mind. It was everywhere, so you had to take a stand. And people might shake their heads and roll their eyes and wish the activists would settle down and use nicer tactics, not block the roads, lean more toward propriety and patience and other ways we've always done it. People might shake their heads and say, these ladies are undisciplined. They're hurting their own cause. But the movement was everywhere by then. You could not not talk about it, could not help but begin to maybe wonder what impelled them, what the issue was, what their problem was, and whether maybe they could have a point, just like movements now. There are other parallels to our time. In 1866, just after the Civil War, a coalition including Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Susan B. Anthony, and Frederick Douglass formed the American Equal Rights Association with the goal of securing the right to vote for all Americans, irrespective, quote, of race, color, or sex. But when the government moved to enfranchise Black men with the 14th and 15th Amendments while continuing to exclude all women, white women suffragists were indignant and defensive. This story is told by the writer Jamelle Bouie in the New York Times. Although Black women activists and also Frederick Douglass continued to fight for universal suffrage, many white women leaders, including and especially Elizabeth Cady Stanton, felt that that was no longer expedient for them. In the interest of their own cause, they lobbied against the vote for newly freed Black men. By contrast, in 1896, Black leaders Ida B. Wells Barnett, Mary Church Terrell, and Harriet Tubman formed the National Association of Colored Women to work for civil rights, including voting rights for everybody. Their motto was "Lifting as we climb." It signaled their firm belief that unless your movement extends its hand to others, unless you pull others up the mountain with you as you struggle, you're not going to reach the top. Despite the great success of those women organizing poor Black women in the South as well as in the North, in 1913, when one of the largest suffrage parades was planned for Washington, D.C., the white organizers demanded that the Black women march not with their state delegations, like everybody, but in an all-Black assembly at the back of the line. Ida B. Wells Barnett refused, and she took her place that day with the women of Illinois. "We are lifting as we climb," they said, even as the liberal white elite tried subtly and not subtly, consciously and subconsciously, to push them down. And in fact, in the summer of 1920, when 35 states had approved the new constitutional amendment and Tennessee became the leading candidate to push it over the finish line, it was a biracial coalition of Nashville women's clubs led by Black women that successfully convinced the legislature to pass the measure on August 18, 50 votes to 46. That's what we celebrate now. Frederick Douglass, who despite the betrayal of his white comrades, remained a staunch supporter of the universal cause and who had been among the 32 men who signed the original Declaration of Sentiments at Seneca Falls in 1848, Douglass said at one point, quote, "When I ran away from slavery, it was for myself. When I advocated for emancipation, it was for my people. But when I stood up for the rights of woman, self was out of the question, and I found a little nobility in the act." More than 100 years ago, Douglass was understanding and speaking and living and risking and breathing through every fiber of his being, the intersected and interconnected, indivisible intertwining of human liberation struggles. And I'm reminded now, paging through this history, how we're always learning and relearning how to do this better, do it well with more integrity, the work of justice and peacemaking, the work of civil rights and human rights and environmental justice and economic justice, how to do humbly and bravely the soul work, the inner work of transformation. Marching only takes us anywhere if we move forward together, in the words of William Barber, forward together, not one step back. It's in the together part that we find a little nobility, that we figure out how to live lives we won't regret, lives that will resonate with the ancestors and with as many generations forward as we can imagine. Ada Limon, the poet, admits in her poem, A New National Anthem, to not liking the old one very much. It's not a good song, she says, but she admits to liking the flag, how it undulates in the wind like water, elemental, and best when it's humbled, brought to its knees, clung to by someone who's lost everything, when it's not a weapon, when it flickers, when it folds up so perfectly you can keep it until it's needed, until you can love it again, until the song in your mouth feels like sustenance, a song where the notes are sung by even the ageless woods, the short grass plains, the Red River Gorge, a fistful of land left unpoisoned, that song that's our birthright, that's sung in silence when it's too hard to go on, that sounds like someone's rough fingers weaving into another's, that sounds like a match being lit in an endless cave, a song that says, my bones are your bones. Your bones are my bones. And isn't that enough? At our best, we're always reaching with the bone and blood and flesh of our hands for other people's hands, reaching with the blood and bone of our stories and our history and our longing for the stories and longing of others, lifting one another as we climb, lifting all the stories, all the longing, all together. Writing in the New York Times Magazine this week, this morning, about the movement for Black lives as it has unfolded in Minneapolis in the last 6 or 7 years, writer Jenna Wortham says, quote, "It is impossible to measure the success of social movements by outcome alone. Instead, we should weigh them against the possibilities they summon." She quotes the scholar Robin DJ Kelly and says, "It is precisely these alternative visions and dreams that inspire new generations to struggle for change. Black Lives Matter is an old prayer spoken in new tongues, articulated in a hashtag. Change is both cyclical and incremental, sometimes nonlinear. Polls," she says, "suggest that as many as 26 million people in the United States, in every state, have participated in demonstrations over the death of George Floyd. Even now, people are still taking to the streets. 6 months ago," still Jenna Wortham writing here, "the notion of abolishing the police was a radical idea, a concept too ambitious for most people to take seriously. Now, defunding and abolishing police departments are topics of rigorous debate and conversation. Victories are slow, but they're happening," she says. And again, the conversation itself, the disagreement, is a victory. The way we hold it, the way we all move forward, curious, carries inherent in itself the goal. Jenna Wortham goes on. "In the days following George Floyd's death, the city of Minneapolis transformed the block of 38th and Chicago into a shrine. Each road that meets at that intersection was barricaded to prevent vehicles from plowing into it. Volunteers kept watch beneath large laminated signs that read, 'This is a sacred space for Black and African Americans.' You didn't need it written down to feel it. Every possible surface, the bus stop, the street, the building walls, the neon sign at the gas station, are all covered in memorials, tributes, paintings, drawings, and pledges in multiple languages, including Spanish, Hebrew, Persian, Thai. The ground feels holy. There are signs to remind people to refrain from taking photos, to wear masks and protect those who come there to pray and reflect and mourn. Within that newly formed town square is a velvet rope draped on gold posts to protect the patch of land where Floyd spent his final moments in this realm. On the ground, someone chalked his body in blue and added wings, and mourners filled the ghostly outlines with candles, toys, shells, rosaries, offerings of fruit and flowers to form a man-shaped garden blooming on concrete, as though the land where he died is itself now fertile, capable of giving birth to something new. This is how I hold the anniversary of suffrage this week. Capable of giving birth to something new. It's the story of one glorious, complicated, imperfect, unfinished struggle intertwined inside us and among us with innumerable others. We are learning as we go, our bones and our stories as intermingled as our breath, if only we'd believe that and honor it. Every moment is the seed of some new transformation. With every step, we're learning to be lifting as we climb, mindful of, grateful for the countless, sometimes nameless ones who've lifted us. "We who believe in freedom cannot rest," said Ella Baker. not needing to clutch for power, not needing the light just to shine on us, she said. We need to be part, a part of the great number as we stand against tyranny. For just a moment, on this end of this week, let's hold silence together. Our hymn is Building a New Way. Will you join me in the closing words? May peace dwell within our hearts and understanding in our minds. May courage steel our will and love of truth forever guide us. Friends, thank you so much for joining us this morning, and thank you for your patience with the internet and all things technological. If you've had trouble at any point during the service today, please remember it's recorded and you can find it on our website and Facebook and YouTube. If you're not receiving our email news, go to the website and sign up. We'll send updates twice a week about groups and gatherings, everything happening here, updates from the board of directors and more. Call or write to us with questions. Call or write to ask for help or to offer help. Please join us in a few minutes at 11:15 for Cyber Social Hour. It's a great way to connect with others in the congregation, to make new friends or renew old friendships. We hope to see you there. We are sending love to you from Maple Street and all of our locations. Stay connected. Stay well, everyone. So be it. See to it. Amen.
The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets. Oh, my sister, marching with me. There go my brother, marching with me. There go my father, marching with me. There go my mother, marching on till the people are free. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets. Hey there, policeman, I can't breathe. Hey there, policeman, I can't breathe. Hey there, policeman, I can't breathe. Lay down your weapons and your badges and listen to me. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets. President Obama, are you marching with me? Can I see a mayor marching with me? Wanna get a senator to march with me? Come join my family as we march toward equality. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets. Maybe tomorrow, when the people are free, maybe tomorrow we'll have equality. Maybe tomorrow I can truly breathe. Till then my voice will fill the streets. Let the people be free. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. The day gonna come when I won't march no more. But while my sister ain't equal and my brother can't breathe, hand in hand with my family, we will fill these streets.